Guy was on the side of the road hitchhiking on a dark night in the midst of a fierce rainstorm. The night was rolling on and no car went by. The storm was so strong he could hardly see a few feet in front of him. And suddenly, through the swirling rain, Bill saw a car slowly coming towards him. As it drew level with him, it stopped, and he was desperate for shelter. And without really thinking about what he was doing, he opened the back door and jumped into the back seat of the car and closed the door. And that's when he realized there was nobody behind the wheel. There was nobody else in the car but him, and the engine wasn't even on. So mysteriously, the car started moving slowly forward. And Bill looked at the road and saw a curb approaching. Now he was scared, began to fear for his life. But just before he reached the curb, a ghostly hand appeared through the window of the car and turned the steering wheel. So Bill is paralyzed with terror, and he watched how the hand appeared every time they came to a curve. When he saw the lights of a diner down the road, Bill gathered all his bravery and strength, jumped out of the car, and ran into the diner. He's wet, he's out of breath, he rushed inside and asked for coffee. He's shaking and half crying. He began to tell everybody about the horrible experience he had just been through. A silence enveloped everybody when they realized he was not out of his mind, but he was for real. About 10 minutes later, two guys walked into the same diner. They were also wet and out of breath. Looking around and seeing Bill sobbing at the counter, the one said to the other, "Hey, Bruce, that's the idiot who got into the car we were pushing." I doubt if that's a true story. Father's Day is celebrated every year on the third Sunday of June. It all began when a young woman wanted to honor her dad in May of 1909. Sonora Smart Dodd of Spokane, Washington, sat in church listening to a Mother's Day sermon, and she decided she wanted to designate a day for her dad. William Jackson Smart Dodd's mother died in childbirth, and Dodd's father, a Civil War veteran, had taken the responsibility of single-handedly raising the newborn and his other five children. The following year, Dodd wanted to celebrate Father's Day on June 5, her father's birthday, and petitioned for the holiday to be recognized in her city. Needing more time to arrange the festivities, Spokane's mayor pushed the date back by 2 weeks, and the Father's Day was celebrated, the first Father's Day, on June 19th of 1910. Eventually, it became a national holiday. John chapter 1, 12 and 13 says, "Yet to all who received him, even to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, nor a husband's will, but born of God. And if we become his children, then God is our Father. Some people have said to me, "We're all God's children." And I had to reply, "No, we're not all God's children. You must become a child of God. You must become a God's child." But then he truly is our Father. Will you bow your heads with me? Dear Lord, being entrusted with these morsels of truth from your word today, I just thank you for that privilege to bring the family, to bring the word into the family today, and I ask that you guide and direct this word and have it to cause the effect that you want it to cause, in Jesus' name, amen. Carol's dad had huge hands like Scotty. Scotty has huge hands. when you shake hands with him, his hand just swallows up. I have a little hands for a guy, so your hand just swallowed up. But he had big hands, Carol's dad. Do you remember your dad taking you by the hand? Can you remember walking as a child, 3 or 4 years old, and your daddy holding your hand and guiding you along? Can you remember that? I can't remember that. Not a whole lot. Of course, that was a long time ago. But can you remember your dad leading you in other ways? Can you remember the leading of your father? Carol's dad was a hard-working guy. He was a machinist most of his life. He had served in World War II as a CB in the Navy in the Pacific Theater. And he never shared any of the ugly things they went through in that war. And I'm sure there were some, because war is ugly. All my dad could remember of his dad, like Scott, like Ken, my dad's father died when he was 3 years old. And the only memory he had of his dad was he would wait on the sidewalk. His dad was a mail carrier. They carried the mail in big leather bags back in those days. And his dad would pick him up, put him in the mail pouch, which was empty at that time, and carry him up into the house. That was the only memory he had of his dad. We have pictures of his dad. We have quite a few in the whole family. My dad's mother had 7 kids when he died, and she was pregnant with the 8th one. 6 of them were girls. My dad had a brother and 6 sisters. But that was all he could remember of his father. So my dad didn't really know how to be a dad. He didn't have anything to pattern himself after. He had some uncles and a grandfather. He made up stories about the grandfather that weren't true. When I see him again in heaven, I'm going to say, "Whoa, what was that all about? Why did you make up those stories?" He said his grandfather came here from Ireland and was in the Civil War. That part was true. But he didn't come from Ireland. He was born in this country. His great-grandfather came from Ireland. But anyway, Dad really didn't know how to be a dad. He did his best to raise us. He did his best to provide for us. He did his best to rescue, me. I hung myself with a clothesline, standing on a retaining wall, and there was a hook above my head, and when they put their clothesline up, they left a piece. Somehow I put that around my neck and slipped off of the wall, and he just happened to see me out the door going like this. Grabbed a butcher knife, ran out there, got a hold of me with one arm and cut that. He wasn't real happy when he explained to me, "Don't you ever do that again." So he rescued me. He did his best to guide us, you know. He was a very a good counselor and very wise. And if we couldn't figure out some other way to get out of the fix we were in, we finally would go to Dad and he'd say, "We'll do this and this and everything will be fine." And he did the best to live a life to show us how we should be, you know, with other people. And we took that to heart, more so than what he would tell us, what we saw him doing. Can you guys all say that was how it is with your dad? He had a hand in everything that I did, if I let him. Because I didn't want him to know about everything that I was doing. And I was pretty sneaky. But he did his best to have a life worth imitating. Things we can learn from our dads just by observing good things and bad things, how to treat people, how not to treat people. I once asked my youngest son, I said, "Was I a bad dad?" He said, "You were really strict." And I was. And they did get spanked a few times. But we appreciate Dad. Do we need to forgive Dad? Some dads have a hard time showing love. Some children have a hard time showing love. Saying I love you is easier than showing love. Saying it's easier than showing it. I can only remember my dad saying, I don't remember him ever saying I love you. I don't remember him ever saying that. Probably did, but I just don't remember. But one time he said, I'm proud of you. And I had graduated from Penn State, and I had my car packed, and I was going to leave shortly for California. I was going to drive all the way to Santa Barbara, California, and earn a bachelor's degree in photography. And he was out on the patio, and I was standing out there with him. And he looked at me in the eye and said, I'm proud of you. And it choked him up to say that. And my reaction was, I turned away and I said, yeah, well, I didn't know how to respond emotionally. Maybe because he didn't teach me that. I don't know. I had a hard time responding. I didn't have an emotional connection. I can't remember my dad with affection. Was that his fault? No. It's nobody's fault. That's just the way it was. And that sort of bothered me. I was thinking about this maybe a year ago, and it came to me that, you know, I don't remember Dad. I admired him. I respected him. But I can't remember him with affection. And it kind of bothered me. And I called my brother up, and I said, you know, this bothers me. I can't remember Dad with affection. He said, neither can I. Called my sister up. She said the same thing. We were loved, but none of the three of us can remember him as we remember and reminisce with affection. We all admired him and respected him and cherish his memory and the things. But, you know, Dad's, that's just the way it was. Dads all make mistakes. We're all human. We're all sinners. And we all need forgiveness. I hope I haven't embittered my kids, because I was probably over the top in discipline sometimes. I was concerned about what kind of men they would become, and they're all fine men. I don't know if I can say they're all fine young men, because one of them's over 50, the other one's going to be 50. I mean, they're not young men anymore, but they're fine men. I'm proud of my sons, and I love them dearly. But our Father God does this, Proverbs 16, 9 and 10. In their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. That was verse 9. God establishes our steps even when we are learning to walk. And he guides us along our walk with him. Can you ever remember being a willful child, pulling your hand away from Dad? I remember my kids pulling their hand away from me. Can you remember trying to please your daddy? Can you remember that? I can. And if I was doing something displeasing, well, I kind of hid that. Because I wanted my parents to be pleased with what I was doing. For the most part, they were, because they didn't know the other side of it. And then the 10th verse, it says, am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. I remember one time when my oldest son was a small child, someone asked him, are you going to be a dad someday? And his answer was, I'm going to be a great big hunting dad. So that was what he saw me doing, going out the door with a shotgun and my hunting clothes on. Yeah, I'm going to be a great big hunting dad. I can remember that so clearly. Several years later, when I told him what he would need to do to become a dad, when I explained to him about the birds and the bees, he asked me, Dad, do you have to? I said, no, but you're going to want to. And he has two children. We have a great big super daddy, our Heavenly Father. Here are some ways that we can make sure that our lives please Him, our great big super daddy. 2 Peter chapter 1, 5 to 7. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. So as we go through that verse, the reason it says for this very reason, if we went back to verse 3 and 4 of 2 Peter chapter 1, it says His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, He has given us very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by even evil desires. So it speaks of four things there: divine power, everything needed for a godly life, knowledge of Him who called us, and promises. So in other words, in Romans 6:22, it says, but now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. We have made ourselves His slaves, but He has made Himself our dad, our great big super daddy. For this reason, it says, we are to have a progression, not just stand still, not to stay where we were when first saved. A change has to take place. So there's required changes. Faith, number one, faith. Our salvation started with faith. His grace, our faith. Ephesians 2:8. For it is by grace you've been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Number two, to that original faith, we are to add goodness. Now that we have experienced deliverance, now that we have experienced escape from certain death, now that we have been set free from the law of sin and death, now that we realize that Jesus paid the penalty for our sins, our life must change. Everything is different. All things are made new. And then the next progression is goodness. Galatians 6:10. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Opportunities are set up. God orchestrates opportunities for us to be good to people. When we do good, it gets people's attention. Every kindness that we can think of, we should do as unto the Lord. Some in the world do kindness. We must do far beyond what the world does. We should let people know that what we are doing for them is coming from the heart of God. It comes from our hand, but from the heart of God, not us. We should never be boastful about what we do. Goodness is not only what we do, but also what we speak. Luke 6:45, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart. And an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. Number three, to goodness we are to add knowledge. There's a difference between opinion and knowledge. Opinion is what you think you know. Opinions lead to enormous mistakes. Opinion is presented as fact. Theories and opinions supported by partial facts and incomplete truths. Some people gather followers because what they're saying has an appeal. You know, like the wacko in Waco. You know who I mean, the wacko in Waco. And there's others, tragic, charismatic leaders that have ended in tragedy. 2 Timothy 4:3-4, for the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. We're living in that time. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. That is why believers absolutely must be rooted and grounded in the Word of God. Amen? We have to know the truth. Your word, O Lord, is forever settled in heaven. 1 Timothy 4:1-2. The Spirit clearly says that in later times some will abandon the faith and will and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Such teachings come through hypocritical liars whose consciences have been seared with a hot iron. You don't have to look very far to find churches whose doctrines are based on snippets of the Bible instead of the whole word. All of the Bible is useful, 2 Timothy 3:16-17. All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And knowledge, the only knowledge we can depend on is the Word of God. There is knowledge that we need to navigate through life in the world, but the knowledge that gets us into eternity with God is His Word. Add knowledge. Knowledge is knowing. We know God. We can know Him personally, and we do. We need to know Him more. Our knowing and our relationship with Him has to become more powerful, more intense, as time goes by. And the fourth one is to knowledge adds self-control. 2:11-13, for the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, while we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So first you get saved by faith in the Lord. Then you add goodness as your behavior changes from the old self-driven person to the new God-driven person. Then you add knowledge so that you will know how to please God. Now that you are gaining knowledge, you are prepared to examine your behavior and attitudes. A change will take place in your desires. This change is called sanctification. Sanctification is a process whereby we become more godly and less worldly. We become less oriented toward pleasing ourselves and more oriented toward pleasing God, toward being holy, in other words. Romans 6:20-23, when you were slaves to sin, you were free from the control of righteousness. What benefit did you reap at that time from the things you are now ashamed of? Those things result in death. Verse 22, but now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the benefit you reap leads to holiness, and the result is eternal life. I read that before, but I didn't read verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus our Lord. We have been set free from the life of sin and death. We dare not go back into it. 1 Peter 14:16, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, be holy, because I am holy. To self-control, add perseverance. Point number five is, we have an enemy that constantly tries to discourage us. Constantly. The enemy never sleeps, never tires, never stops trying to destroy the work of God in us. Our path is rocky. Our path is steep. We face obstacles. Some become homeless. When I first came here, there was a flood, and two of our families never could go back to their homes. Became homeless in that year. Tragedy comes. Hardship comes. Our bodies wear out. We get gout. We get heart troubles. We get all kinds of stuff. Our children don't always do what we think they should. Grief and trials are part of our walk. We also have great joys. We have great victories. Life is satisfying and rewarding in spite of the trials if we persevere. There is a task before us, carrying the light of the truth of the gospel in the dark places in people's lives is our task. Many people come to Christ because of hardship. Nowhere to turn. Turn to God. Perseverance is staying in the battle. God is on our side. Luke 9:62, Jesus replied, "No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God." In Galatians 6, 9, and 10, let us now not become weary in doing good. Almost slipped into King James. Weary in well doing, King James. For at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. The proper time is the key, because what we want is now. But God owns the time. He started the time. He owns the time. So the proper time is, that belongs to him. Amen. Therefore, verse 10, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Number six, to perseverance, add godliness. Godliness is an internal condition. It's not piety with folded hands and upturned eyes like this. Godliness comes from a reverent awe of God. He is awesome. He created the universe. He set everything in motion. He is omnipotent. He is omniscient. He is omnipresent. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He is the great I Am. He is Yahweh. He is great Jehovah. He is Lord, and he is my best friend. And he's my great big super daddy. Isaiah 6:8. When I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." Talking about godliness, being willing, knowing God, seeing him, and seeing his works around us, in us, and through us will cause us to want to be like him, and more importantly, to do his bidding. Here I am, send me. Too many Christians are saying, "Here I am, bless me, but send somebody else." Too many are saying, "Here I am, bring me something." Too many are saying, I can't do this. I can't be a pastor. But I am anyway. I'm doing it anyway. We must consider our ways and attitudes and see if they are godly. You have to examine yourself. Number 7, to godliness, add mutual affection. We need to see each other the way God sees us. We need to see each other. Say, show me how you see that person. We need to have a melted heart towards each other. The affection that we have for each other has to be extended then to outsiders. I mean those outside the faith, outside of the truth, because we want them to be inside with us. Amen? They need to see our loving concern for each other. Affection is attractive. It doesn't draw bugs, it draws people. We should never be a church that has bickering. I've been in those churches. Fortunately, we don't have that here. We have a loving spirit here. But I have been in churches like that. It shouldn't happen in God's churches. Mutual affection has to rule. I've been around bickerers. That unkindness is harmful to the church and harmful to the work. The work of the church isn't to get together, sing a few songs, and listen to the preacher. The work of the church is what happens that we each carry when we go out of here and affect unbelievers. Ephesians 4:32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. So you have to forgive me. Romans 12:10, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. And then number 8, to mutual affection add love. A love of good will to all people must be added to the delight we have for each other in mutual affection or brotherly love. God loves all, John 3:16. His love is obvious. He died on the cross. He who knew no sin, God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. What is the result of all these things being added one to another, to another, to another in 2 Peter 5 through 7? For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. We pick it up then in verse 8. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measures, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Do we want to be effective and productive? I do. Do we need to have all those qualities? Well, that's what it says. Yes, we do. Do you want to be able to say, here I am, send me? Ezekiel 22:30, I looked for someone to among them who would build up the wall and stand before me in the gap on behalf of the land so I would not have to destroy it. But I found no one. What will he find when he looks at you? As dads, we all have our failures. Our dads have failed us at times. Like I said, my dad didn't know how to be a dad because he didn't grow up with a dad to pattern after. He thought he was doing the right thing, and mostly he probably was. Our Heavenly Father will never fail us. He makes no mistakes. We may fail. We may fail as sons and daughters, but He forgives us, strengthens us, guides us with His strong hands, our Daddy's hands. These things will please Him: faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, and love. That is how we please our Heavenly Father. For the loving hand of our true Father, we have everything that we really need. From His hand, we have salvation. From His hand, we have guidance. From His hand, we have the Scriptures. One sweet, holy, happy day, His hand will pat us on the back and dry our tears. And He will say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord." Amen. Amen. So as fathers, well, we've all made mistakes and done things that weren't that weren't the best. We all have. But God never makes a mistake. God never does. So we have that perfect dad in heaven. He's perfect. Amen. Would you stand? I have some Father's Day gifts on the railing down here. I always go to Harbor Freight to buy Father's Day things. So you can all pick something. Stevie, you can pick something for your dad and take it home if you want to. All right? And so I want the dads all to come down. And I want to pray a prayer.